For the past several months, cowards have hid behind anonymous social media accounts to libel, threaten, and bully event organizers. They've used intimidation tactics toward faculty advisors and have spread misinformation as a desperate attempt to shut this event down. And because that didn't work, they are protesting outside tonight. Well, it's okay to disagree, but we have worked hard to hold this private event, so any attempt to shut it down will not be tolerated and repeat offenders will be removed. With that, please help me welcome Senior Breitbart Editor, Milo Yiannopoulos.
They're lovely. They're lovely. Hello. Hi. You might not know this because you're at the front, but everybody else is standing. Thank you so much. Thank you. I love the... Oh, this is lovely. I was supposed to dress as a Roman emperor today, but I got a little bit caught up outside. I did. I can show you, actually. I got a little bit waylaid outside. Do we have that? Oh, wonderful. Yeah, that's it. We're buying Pokemon. Leave us alone.
Pokemon's better than Yu-Gi-Oh. How about just Yu-Gi-Oh?
Why do you want them?
Because we can get rare ones and then make money.
No.
Can I get Yu-Gi-Oh cards, please, Dad? Is that a yes?
Stop it.
Let's get this.
All right, yeah. So we'll do that. The others will just dish out between us. You have black clothes, yeah? All right.
Okay, I'm gonna be taking pictures secretly.
Okay.
These stars vowed to leave America, now they're begging for forgiveness, and it just lists them off like a firing squad.
All right, could you grab the big things?
Because what if I am people of color? You don't know. You can't tell me what my skin tone is. You can try.
Low-key trying to eat another Hot Pocket.
Low-key?
You don't want dead. I'm just trying to. No, it was just like one of those things, like, spew escalate, 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 and then just get stuck in your face. We're gonna go and protest my own event. I've picked a sign that is both, well, I mean, it's true, whichever way you look at it.
Yeah! Stop letting bigotry into our schools!
We just went outside, said hello to the protesters. They spotted me quite quickly, I guess. I don't know. I must be noticeable or something. We had a lot of fun. It was okay. Actually, there was a big crowd, and most of them seemed to be supportive. I think they were just there to see the crazies. You know?
Yes. We'll come to this. We'll get to it. We'll get to it. You had some lovely people outside. They were lovely. They didn't quite understand that everyone they thought had shown up to support them was on my staff. But we have good outfits. We were all in black. We got the balaclavas, the ski masks. Milo sucks. Well, yes. It was lovely. All right, look. Let's get to the serious stuff. No, not Siri. Siri, go fuck yourself. Okay. Thank you so much for coming. Welcome to the Dangerous Faggot Tour. Thank you. Thank you very much. I've come dressed, depending on your perspective, either as a sort of late decadent period Roman emperor meets protester, or sort of 14th century Muslim, too much makeup and a predilection for 7-year-old boys. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. All right. Maybe because of my Greek heritage, I've always dreamed of being Spartan. I have. I have. Sometimes people accuse me of wanting to take America back to the 50s. And I say, well, yes, the 650s, BC, when men were men and men fucked men throughout life. Went out to fight wars and were thoroughly respectable and reasonable and wouldn't have stood for this shit. Right. Now, not so much to be part of one of the most fanatical armies on Earth, but I would have liked to be a Spartan, partly for the sweaty man orgies, but partly also because, look to the left of this picture. Is that an atom bomb? It's not very aerodynamic, is it? I think it might be a Photoshop. the Blue Mosque. Anyone been to Istanbul? Anyone been to Istanbul? No, you're not wasting your time. Until we win it back. Until it is Constantinople again. There's no point going. Why would you go? Why would you go? They had the gall to convert, to convert churches into mosques. When that thing is once again pointed toward Rome, then it's probably worth going to Turkey. All right, okay. This speech is about war, something America came to terms with dramatically 3/4 centuries ago. Today, the 75th anniversary of Japan's attack on the American Navy at Pearl Harbor. We should all bow our heads for a moment and thank God for the men in Navy uniforms who keep us free, and also for being so hot. Not quite as gay as the Air Force, but a little more sexually malleable than the Army. They are definitely my favorites. Navy men are behind a great deal of Western civilization's progress in recent centuries, including such things as quashing the loathsome trade in slaves, which was mixed up with the Barbary pirates, who of course worshipped Allah. And for most of those recent centuries, it was my homeland's glorious British Navy who deserved most of the credit. In the middle of the last century, we gloried in that. Britain has gone down the path of leftist guilt for its imperial past, but I'm glad the United States is still proud, for the most part, of its military history. And it should be. Quite like for it to be proud of its military future, too, which we'll talk about this evening. Of course, since that fateful day 75 years ago, the baton has passed from the Royal Navy to your own glorious U.S. Navy. U.S. Navy now, the best naval force in the world. The best... it is. Long may it guard the freedom of us all. And let's not forget the Navy has given this country's leaders like John Fitzgerald Kennedy, and more recently Stephen K. Bannon, one of Donald Trump's latest appointments. So one of many, many very admirable naval graduates. I've personally been wondering why leftists only compare Trump to Hitler and never to Japan's Emperor Hirohito. I guess they're racist against Asians. We'll return to this war theme. We will return to this in a minute. I have to touch on your school and on the state of Michigan. Now, one of the favorite things I've learned about Michigan State is that they set up a women's course in 1896. What trailblazers you were. But it wasn't gender studies. It wasn't women's studies as we know it today. They taught women home economics, cooking, liberal arts, and some science. So the women's course was actually a useful degree. It didn't just teach those women who opted to be homemakers how to be homemakers, but it also taught women who wanted to turn themselves into the next great NASA scientist or mathematician how to do that too. It didn't teach women how to indulge in grievance and victimhood and whining for a living. It taught women how to actually do things and how to execute their aspirations and their dreams. And your university was one of the very first places anywhere in the Western world to provide an education for women to do that. Of course, being a useful degree that actually taught something productive, how to turn into the perfect wife, the perfect American wife. Who wouldn't want to come home? Even I, might be tempted. If I were to come home at sort of 6:15, 6:20 every evening to a hot, steaming roast dinner, and her, even I could be moved. But not, you know, unlike most women's studies degrees, it wasn't preparing women for a lifetime of begging on Patreon. It wasn't preparing women for a lifetime of online servitude. Now, in October, I have to tell you, Michigan State was part of a nationwide hoax of scary clown sightings. You all remember this? Remember your clown sightings? My goodness, I was very excited about it. During the month leading up to the election, scary clowns made more appearances than Hillary Clinton did on the campaign trail. Now, they did. Which is to say, none. Now, you have finally on campus got a genuinely scary clown. So you're welcome. And look. I understand that some 200 of your fellow students formed a clown posse to hunt them down, which turned turned out about as successfully as a left-wing journalist's hunt for college rape cases, which is to say, no confirmed cases ever found. Now you've found yourself, as I say, a truly scary clown. I'm going to be very disappointed. The angry, frightened social justice posse they whip up against me doesn't exceed 200. The state of Michigan, not just your college, but your state, voted for Trump. You voted for Trump. Almost an inconceivable sort of victory. It was a wonderful thing to watch. Now, of course, the fake news media, by which I mean CNN, the New York Times, and all the other people who have lied to and lied about you for decades, never considered the white working class residents of Michigan might not like being called evil racists clinging to guns and Bibles. Wasn't a surprise to Daddy, of course, who campaigned here to great success, because he knew the Democrats were fucked. He flipped it like so many New York apartments before. Good job, Michigan. Finally, at last, congratulations, you did something better than Ohio. Well done. Oh, come on. You've got to take a little too. I take plenty. Is it, oh, you know, you've got to read yourself before you can read other people, you know? Yes, well, finally you beat Ohio or something. Okay, I can't resist. I can't help myself but take shots at my fans. It's my form of affection, you know? We always hurt the ones we love. Can you believe it took the state of Michigan all the way until right before Thanksgiving to certify the vote for Trump? It's almost like they didn't want to admit that Trump won. Perhaps their Soros-funded vote counters broke down in a crying fit every time they're about to confirm the results. The rural counties, of course, uneducated small-town hicks, as the Democrats would call you, all came through for Trump with amazing vote totals. Over 12 counties that voted for Obama switched over to. It's something to celebrate, the decent people of Michigan defeating the Detroit's Democrat machine. Now, as a foreigner, I used to think of Michigan, you know, you come to America and you sort of try to learn what the states are about. You know, sort of Texas, awesome. Of course it is. You know, Vermont, cancerous. And you learn about Michigan and you sort of have these pictures in your mind of this sort of post-apocalyptic wasteland. Burning cars, dead bodies in the streets, you know, you know, zombies wandering the corridors, burned out abandoned factories, and it turns out that's only Detroit. The rest of Michigan is really nice. It's actually only the Democrat controlled areas that are a disaster. This is Detroit before the Democrats came into power. This is it afterwards. There you go. And so the black community has not recognized the pattern here. They've not picked up on what happens if, you know, there's a definition of madness. You know, you keep doing the same thing expecting a different result. You keep voting in Democrat mayors, keep voting in Democrat presidents, expecting your life to get better. Well, your life is not going to get better. Your life is going to end up like this. That brings us to the most interesting election news in the state of Michigan. Jill Stein's recount effort. Jill Stein is a crazy old cunt who... I am informed by my researchers, ran for president this year. I'd never heard of her. Honestly, I paid really close attention to this stuff. I'd never heard of her before this recount stuff. She got 50,000 votes from this state, but somehow has the right to waste $12 million of your taxpayer money for a recount. Now, my research team tells me she's part of something called the Green Party. You'd think that she'd want that $12 million to make Flint's water less green. But no, she wasn't interested in the environment. It's all about her. She saw Bernie Sanders cash in when he caved to Hillary Clinton. She wanted a piece of the action, too. Is she still collecting donations? Anyone know? It is. I wonder how fat her bank account is now. This is the lizard people-eyed Jill Stein meme we discovered today. No refunds. Of course, they will not find any fraud with Trump's efforts. The entire effort is just so fear, uncertainty, and doubt into the American psyche as we approach the inauguration of the glorious God Emperor. Daddy. Daddy President. President Daddy. I'm going to host a little party on inauguration. Oh, stop it. Stop it. Stop it. No. No. No, you wouldn't want that. I mean, imagine how boring that would be, watching me do this every day of the week. Just ritually, publicly humiliating the New York Times, the Washington Post, Politico, I know there's one of them here, sending them all to the back and putting, you know, E! Entertainment Television and Vice and Breitbart and InfoWars at the front, and on Tuesdays I'd only answer questions about fashion, you know, what Ivanka's wearing today. On Fridays I'd show up in drag. You don't want that. You don't want that. That'd be awful. That'd be so boring. Goodness, no, good heavens, no. No, no, maybe. We'll see. What? Oh, Ivana Wall. Oh, have you seen Ivana Wall? You know, my drag alter ego, Ivana Wall? No, she's hot. She would be conducting the briefings. I would be my own deputy press secretary. On Fridays, Ivana Wall would conduct the press briefings, and she'd answer very serious questions about foreign policy in full drag. It'd be wonderful. Call me, you bastards. Right. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, 6 days of recounts in Wisconsin. 6 days have netted a total of how many votes for Hillary? Zero. Zero votes for Hillary. Very sad. According to the Detroit News, over half of Detroit's votes may be ineligible for recounts. Turns out those corpses in the street that voted for Hillary the first time can't be counted the second. Those dead people and zombies and people who never existed who voted for the Democrats mysteriously could not be found. Very stupid of them to ever try to do a recount in Michigan. Now we've won the election. We did it. We've won. Trump is in. Trump can start to make America great again. In fact, he's already doing it. I'll push our job is to push forward and to win the culture war. Now, the culture war takes many different shapes, many different forms. Sometimes it's the battle against campus cry bullies. You saw some of them outside this evening. I came dressed as one before I put on my laurel wreath. Sometimes it looks like that. Sometimes it's as simple as quote retweeting Lena Dunham and saying, "You are a disgusting fat cunt. piss off to Canada like you promised." But sometimes it looks different. Sometimes you have to treat college not like a daycare center, as your left-wing compatriots would like to do, but as a place for controversial ideas. Today we're going to look at a culture war in a much larger scope, and it's a culture war that has been going on for hundreds, in fact thousands of years. It's a culture war that represents a clash of civilizations, and it is the war between Western civilization and radical Islam, or as I like to call it, Islam. I don't care to make the distinction. Now, I know they don't teach you much world history, and I don't want to turn this into a history lecture, but it's critical you understand this is not a new fight. This is not something that just started to happen. Constantinople was the capital of the Byzantine Empire, which was also once known as the Eastern Roman Emperor in its best days. Its fall to Islam in 1453 was a blow the empire never recovered from. Symbolically, it ended the empire, no matter how you look at it. It was bad for Western civilization. Hundreds of years prior, Islam had made big inroads into conquering Europe. Spain especially, and Sicily for some time, both had the misfortune of living under Islam. Now, I know Americans are not great at geography, but try to imagine if you can. I'll help you through it, okay? This is Europe. Europe's really important and cool. Okay. This is... what? What? If you're going to interrupt, make it funny and interesting. What did you say? No. Okay. If you're over to Eastern Europe here, Turkey, the Middle East. No, I've got family in Cyprus. They took our fucking orange groves, 1976. Never forget. Okay. No, I'd be even richer if they hadn't done that. Okay, so this is the Middle East over here, Super Saharan Africa. Anyway, so these are the battles that Islam fought to conquer the West. Lots of them. And by comparison, this is where the Crusades happened. So when you are told that... it's ancient history. You know, Islam is a religion of peace, of course. And what about the Crusades? Well, what about the fucking Crusades? Because historically speaking, geographically speaking, mathematically speaking, this is the territory that Muslims fought over. And that's where the Crusades happened. Just to give you some perspective. What? Police officers haven't turned their ringtones off. It's fine. I don't dare criticize. All right. In 732 AD, an army from Arab-controlled Spain penetrated all the way to Tours, which is just 150 miles from Paris. They were beaten back by the Frankish king Charles Martel. You should know him. He was the daddy of his day. if he hadn't succeeded... the Muslims could well have dominated all of Europe. But Charles Martel beat them back. And he was OG daddy. In the same era, Arabs had also laid siege to Constantinople twice. And 100 years later, were raiding Rome itself. People don't know this stuff because it isn't taught in history class, but Muslims have never stopped trying to conquer Europe. Since there has been Islam, there have been attempts by Muslim leaders to take over Europe in a variety of different ways, using different strategies, whether it is demographics, the refugee crisis, or war. And fortunately, we have had in the past, although not today, we have had in the past leaders who have resisted that. Now, leftist commentators and colonial studies professors, do you have a colonial studies department here? They constantly bring up the Crusades as an example of Western aggression against Muslims, but they neglect to mention that the Crusades were a response to centuries of Muslim invasion of Europe. and they paled in comparison to the Arab attacks on the continent. If you ever hear this feeble argument, simply show them the map I showed you earlier. Could we go back to the map I showed them earlier? Show them the map I showed you earlier and ask them to justify their statements. You will hear them stuttering and stammering in response. There we go. So the Muslim invasion of the West isn't new. But who would have thought that modern Europe wouldn't fall? Not because of a bearded man with a goat-fucking fixation, but because of Western women. Here. Now, she's not a looker, is she? You know, she looks like a puppet. You know, this bit of the mouth could just sort of... I imagine George Soros down here somewhere. Well, quite. You've got a bright future in headline writing ahead of you. There we go. Just imagine the leaders of Europe through all of its glorious centuries. Charles Martel, Charlemagne, Richard the Lionheart. Imagine what they would make of the actions of Angela Merkel. I'm surprised the very ground of Europe hasn't been torn asunder by knights of yesteryear, wresting themselves from the dirt, rising up in horror and pain at what she has done. Now, the reason that hapless women up this hapless woman up here made her mistake is that she assumed that Islam had changed. She assumed that the sorts of historical forces that have led to Christianity changing, becoming adaptable to modern fashions, whether it's political fashions or social fashions or whatever. I mean, for instance, you'll never hear a Catholic bishop talk about God. He talks a lot about climate change and diversity. But you'll very rarely hear them talk about God. Now, that's sort of excessive because the Catholic Church, I mean, we invented social justice, I'm sorry to tell you. But, you know, all Christians have this sort of, on the one hand, a sort of embarrassing failing, but on the other, a kind of a strength, which is sort of infinite malleability and adaptability to modern circumstance. And of course, capitalism couldn't have survived without Christianity. Couldn't have existed, couldn't have grown without Christianity. It was the Protestant work ethic that made capitalism possible. But Islam hasn't gone through that same journey, and making the mistake that all religions have gone through that journey is what most European leaders are doing, and what she did in particular. Now, Father James Shawl of Georgetown University chronicled this as part of his brilliant work on the culture clash with Islam. It was called Belloc on the Apparently Unconvertible Religion. Now, Father Shawl observes that in 1938, when Western intellectuals thought Christianity was over, thought it was basically done, like there would be no more Christians for a while, and Islam was even more dead because it apparently perished with the Ottoman Empire, that Hilaire Belloc, one of the great thinkers of our intellectual history, had other ideas. And Belloc wrote in The Great Heresies, "Men of foresight may justly apprehend, or at any rate expect, the return of Islam." And why? Well, because foolish people assume that Muslims' backwardness in material things like modern science dooms the religion as a force. There is no world-class university anywhere in the Muslim world. Not one. Anywhere, any Muslim country, there is not a single university you would want to move to. This is one you might end up in. Not one you would move to. There are nuclear physicists in Pakistan who believe that the equipment they have bought from overseas to run their nuclear reactors is powered by fairies. Not. Nothing wrong with gay scientists. No, jinn. Jinn, D-J-I-N-N, jinn, a sort of the Islamic version of fairies, in their particular religious culture. They believe that the nuclear reactors are run by jinn, the stuff they bought from elsewhere. This is the sort of standard in the Islamic world. Now, Belloc observes that in faith, we in the West have fallen inferior to Islam. He believes that we've fallen behind it. He knew that if we believe in nothing, if we're snowflakes who won't risk our reputation, much less our life, for any kind of objective truth, then we will fall in the face of fanatics who have stronger and bloodier beliefs than we do. The Christian kingdoms in Europe shouldn't have retaken Constantinople. The Christian kingdoms of Europe should have retaken Constantinople, but they didn't. Now, we must learn from their mistakes and, I think, retake Europe before it's too late. Western civilization needs to get up off its ass before it is on its knees before Allah, or hurled off a roof, if they have the same dick-sucking predilection that I do. They're as gay as me. Don't you know there's a war on? Well, they do. It's the worst kind of war, cultural or otherwise. It's the kind of war where only one side realizes there's a fight on. Think about the regressive left's infiltration of the university establishment. They've taken it over so completely that the emergence of peer-reviewed papers like The Perilous Whiteness of Pumpkins seems normal and important. I'm not joking, by the way. That's the actual title of a paper published in Taylor and Francis. This is the sort of thing that your academics concern themselves with. And this is not, this is, you know, this is 18th of November 2015. I mean, this is, you know, it's not a recent moment of madness. You know, this is the kind of thing that American academics preoccupy themselves with. This is what they're talking about. And this is why Douglas Murray, who is another smart, charming British homosexual you should listen to, says that we will be fretting over transgender pronouns when the Mullahs nuke us. He's not wrong. Now, openly racist lectures about white people are also a common sight on American campuses. This is an example from BuzzFeed just from, I think, today, of the sorts of things that are often taught on American campuses. White people are a plague to the planet. Administrators, university presidents, faculty members all consider this to be completely normal, a perfectly reasonable line of academic inquiry. They don't register any objections. Well, me and Pepe the Frog are considered forces of bigotry. Some preposterously theatrical fag and a green cartoon frog on Twitter are considered hateful. While this beer is awful. I heard they rebranded themselves America, but it hasn't made it taste any better. This is apparently a proper inquiry for American college campuses. Now, these speeches come from BuzzFeed, by the way, which praised these lectures. Praised these lectures. This was part of a series. You can see the number 9 over there. Part of a series in BuzzFeed praising these lectures for, quote-unquote, not giving a fuck. Not giving zero fucks, actually, to be precise. This is how the culture war has gone with Islam. The West, particularly Western Europe, has remained aggressively and in some cases deliberately ignorant about what is happening on their once great continent. Do you think Muslims are ignorant of the culture clash? Of course not. It's been pounded into their heads since birth at mosques that continue to become more and more separatist. That it's drilled into them that Muslims, that Islam is something unique and something different. Now, well-meaning Americans, and this is where I'm going to get real with you, if anything I just said was not, you know, wasn't extreme enough for you. There's a theological point that well-meaning, well-educated, nice Americans don't always understand. You assume because America hasn't experienced large volumes of working-class Islamic immigration, you presume that Muslims are just like, you know, any other people, that Islam is just like any other religion. Christians can get along perfectly fine in non-Christian countries when they're not being executed by the locals. So why can't Muslims? Well, that's because there's something structurally different about Islam. Islam divides the world into the house of Islam, Dar al-Islam, and the rest of the world. And there is only really, you know, two ways to treat the rest of the world, which is assimilation or extermination. And when you understand that about Islam, you realize that there is something structurally, intrinsically different about this particular religion that makes it wholly and completely incompatible with the modern progressive project of multiculturalism. And, of course, you know, for other reasons, completely incompatible with freedom, democracy, property rights, capitalism, and all the other things that have made this country the best, I mean, it's the greatest country in the history of human civilization. America is the greatest country that we have yet produced in our species. Weaker countries fall more quickly to this stuff. Consider the case of Germany, which has become the textbook example of how Europe is falling to Islam. A recent study by Die Welt shows that immigrants no longer identify as German. They don't want to be known as Germans, and in fact, many of them find that description insulting. They identify themselves as Turks or whatever country they come from, and above all else, as Muslims. Germany has changed so much so quickly that even the aforementioned odious Angela Merkel, even she has started to realize what she has done. started to realize what she's done and suggested that maybe it would be a good idea if the full burqa wasn't seen on German streets. Well, too little, too late, good try, good luck, fat chance. You've already fucked your country. She's sort of floundering, panicking, desperately hoping that she hasn't done something irreversible. Well, she has done something irreversible. Germany's response to this trend only makes sense in a country where gang rapes of thousands of women in cities were underreported because the gangs were Muslim men. It's lucky we had so many fake news outlets to report the truth, isn't it? By the way, have you heard about this fake news thing? This is what CNN is pushing now, fake news, which they will describe, vast right-wing conspiracies about, for instance, Hillary's health, except, oh, wait, no, she was actually sick. All the other variety of weird and bizarre things that we weren't supposed to believe until they actually turned out to be true. Well, my definition of fake news is a little different, and conspiracy theory is a little different. There are two, that fake news is reporting on something ugly about our own friends. Conspiracy theory is a story we will not investigate for ideological reasons. Now, there are all sorts of things that you will hear about from the progressive press that you're not supposed to look into, that you're not supposed to take seriously because they're considered fake news or conspiracy theories. Well, what the press is telling you when they say these things, when they say fake news or conspiracy theory, these buzzwords, what should be set off in the back of your head is, we don't want to look into this because we might not like the results. We might not like the conclusions that you draw after you have access to the facts. Oh, Pizzagate. Should we talk about Pizzagate? Yeah. Okay, all I will say... What's that? All I will say on this subject, because I do have a large talk on this plan that I want to save for when I've had a properly, when I'm... less drunken. Just kidding. All I will say is it's interesting, isn't it, that you've been lied to and about so much by the media, you're prepared to believe almost anything about Democrats. the trust in the media has been brought so low. And the left's sinister pandering to pedophiles has become so blatant. If you've read Salon, gives a platform to people like Todd Nickerson, this guy who says he's a virtuous pedophile because he wants to fuck kids but doesn't. The media has so debased itself that you're prepared to believe almost anything about the Democrats. I'm going to save it for a future talk, I'm sorry. Let's get back to the subject at hand. Sociologist Annabel Tribal believes that it is Germans who should integrate into migrant cultures and not the other way around. Because it's our job to make the newcomers feel welcome. Other academics who see the idea of German culture as proto-fascist have called for mandatory Arabic lessons for all German children. It's so stupid. These attitudes don't sound, I'm sorry to tell you, too far away from the modern American left. After all, I'm not here speaking to you about Europe. Only for the good of my beloved United Kingdom, because since we have Brexit now, we have a hope of saving ourselves from this absolute fucking horror show. But also because what's happening in Europe will happen in America soon, if you don't watch out. Now, electing Donald Trump was the best thing you could have done to head this off, and I hope that it has effect. But I've saved the best German leftist for last, and it's a vision of a horrifying future that is ahead of you if you don't take this subject seriously. Green Party member, it's always the Greens. Green Party member Kurt Edler proposed that Syrian asylum seekers shouldn't be expected to integrate in German society. It's asking too much. Instead, they should be given their own new city in Germany called New Aleppo. Oh, stop it. Refuse to believe that anyone in this room, anyone, even the progressive protesters who are hiding themselves at the back, I refuse to believe anyone in this room is as stupid as the Libertarian Party candidate for president. I think you all know You all know where Aleppo is and what it is. They've so thoroughly destroyed old Aleppo, he wants to give them a new one to destroy. Now, Muslims know that Islam clashes with Western civilization. They make no bones about choosing Islam over their new home country, like Syrians in Germany or this nice Somali gentleman at Ohio State University. You know, I mean, I shouldn't laugh, but I can, because the only person who died was him, thank God. Glad he's dead. But this is a guy... This is a guy who was studying microaggressions at university and who said in August to a student media publication, he said, you know, something along the lines of, you know, I'm just really sick of being like typecast as a Muslim, you know, like every time people tell me I'm a Muslim, I tell them I'm a Muslim, kind of people kind of like look at me a bit suspiciously. 3 months later, he was driving his car into 9 people. Somebody who has been encouraged by the insane politics of the progressive left to believe that he is a victim. And it wasn't a victim. It wasn't a victim. It was just a cunt. Now, Muslims are surprisingly open and honest in polls because they know they have nothing to fear, from the governments who welcome them with open arms. I want to quote from a Pew Global poll from 2013 about attitudes in Islamic countries. The people of Islamic nations also believe that Western nations do not respect Arab or Islamic values. Good, we don't. They're crap. Do not support Arab causes. Good, we don't. They're crap. And do not exhibit fairness towards Arabs, Muslims, or in particular the situation in Palestine. Why should we? They're fucking terrorists. Some of those were quotes, some of those weren't. Some of you may not understand why I'm quoting a poll about Islamic nations when I'm talking about the West, but those are the people you're welcoming here. Muslims flooding into Germany and the rest of Europe aren't older or moderate Muslims from the United Kingdom or the United States. They're more radical, and they reflect the values and the morals of Islamic countries. One of the easiest ways to get a sense for Islam's habit of tightly controlling every land it takes over is attitudes around Sharia law. Now, Sharia law is Islamic religious law, which remarkable number of Muslims in the West believe should supersede the law of the country in which they live. In 2015, the Center of Security Policy commissioned a poll of Muslims in America. It found that 30% of American Muslims believe that it is legitimate to use violence against those who insult Islam. Let's be clear what that means. 3 in 10 Muslims believe that if you joke about Muhammad, they have the right to punch you. Or worse, shoot you. Blow you up. As is their favorite method of... Oh, I mean, you know, in the West we have this sort of, long tradition of civilized debates. So, sir, I find your proposition unacceptable. Other places in the world, it's just... Thirty percent. Not of Muslims in Saudi Arabia, not of Muslims in Aleppo, not of Muslims in anywhere else that you might have dimly heard of, that you might vaguely be aware of, but Muslims here, 3 in 10, believe that if you make a joke about Islam, they are justified in committing violent acts against you. 33%, and this is way more chilling, way more terrifying for you guys, said that Sharia should take precedence over the Constitution if they clash. So if, for instance, the First Amendment the First Amendment says you can be, do, and say whatever you want, but Sharia says insult Muhammad and you die, 1 in 3 Muslims believe you should die. Here. Not in Saudi Arabia. Here. According to a Wenzel Strategies poll in 2012, 58% of Muslim Americans believe criticism of Islam or Muhammad is not protected free speech under the First Amendment. That is to say, just about 60% of them think that I can't say I find Islam to be shit and be protected under the First Amendment. 45% that believe that those who mock Islam should face criminal charges. 12%, this is my all-time favorite, this is my all-time favorite statistic about American Muslims, and I'm not sure it's even this bad in Britain or Belgium, and both of those places are pretty fucking terrible as far as Islamic attitudes go. 12% of American Muslims believe that Islam, that blaspheming against Islam, joking about Muhammad, or saying that Islam sucks, should be punishable by death. 1 in 10. These people live close to you. They study with you. Some of them might even teach you. 1 in 10. Death. 26% of young Muslims in America believe that suicide bombings are justified, because of course they do. It shouldn't surprise us, given everything that's happened. And 35% of young Muslims in Britain believe that suicide bombings are justified too. You're lucky. Only a quarter of your Muslims think that suicide bombings are all right. You're okay. A third of ours do. But you're okay. Only 1 in 4 of your Muslim friends think that suicide bombings are justified. My fucking God, what is wrong with you people? What is wrong with you people? You have not learned your lesson after 9/11. You have not learned your lesson after Orlando. You have not learned any of the lessons these people have been perfectly happy to teach you. Obama's welcoming in 12.5 Syrian migrants. Not refugees, they're migrants. Thank you. In the dying days of his presidency, when he knows he can sort of get away with anything because people are paying attention to Trump and Hillary. 12,500. Not even the start. Imagine what's happening in Canada and how easy it will be for them to get over the border. All right, now the most important part. If that wasn't all horrifying enough, 45% of Sharia supporters surveyed disagreed with the idea that Islamic law should apply only to Muslims. So, what this means is 45% of people who believe that there should be Sharia law in the United States, that's half of them, every other one who says that they like Sharia law, says that it shouldn't only apply to Muslims, it should apply to you too. So, women, could you stand up in the room, please? The girls, could you stand up? Lots of them. More women than are normally at my talks.
Are you assuming their gender?
No. I wasn't assuming anyone's gender. I asked ladies to stand up. They identified themselves as women. So fuck you. But yes, they are women because they were born with vagges. Now, your testimony in court is worth half that of mine. That's what every other Muslim in this country who wants Sharia law enacted believes is reasonable and appropriate and law inspired by the divine. Allah wishes it. Your testimony is worth half that of a man's. Progressives have the fucking gall to suggest that these people are victims, these people are deserving, that Islamophobia is a thing, that these people should be given special treatment over the women they oppress and the homosexuals they execute. Fuck Hillary Clinton and her pandering to gays at home whilst taking hundreds of millions of dollars. Taking hundreds of millions of dollars from Saudi Arabia from people who believe this. I don't believe any of the people standing in this room. I don't believe any of their testimony is worth half that of a man's. In many cases, they may be more sensible than a man's. I don't believe that about women, despite my reputation as misogynist, because I don't happen to like a sort of crazy third-wave feminism. I happen to love women. Where would gay men be without women? We need you to go shopping. We need you to hang out with us. You know, we need you to cry with us when our boyfriends leave us. I'm just kidding. I've actually never been dumped, just to say. But all the people I've dumped have needed women to... I don't believe that your testimony is worth half that of a man's. Nor do I believe that whipping and beating you is a perfectly reasonable response. to bad behavior? No. Nor do I believe that you should be stoned to death for fucking someone else. You can sit down. Thank you so much. Nor do I believe that either, but half of the Sharia supporters surveyed do think those things, and they don't just think that it should apply to Muslim communities, they think it should apply to you too. This is the sort of caliphate building I've been telling you about. This is the sort of stuff that I've been warning you about. Now, you can kiss goodbye to your bacon, by the way, because people who believe that Sharia law should apply to everyone believe that this sort of stuff should not be available no matter what faith you are. The good news is that according to CNN, if you want to sort of want to bring out your humanitarian instincts, the good news is that the only people coming here from Syria are needy women and children. The only people coming here from... No, they're not. They're all huge quantities of them, particularly in Europe, as we've seen in Germany, are 22-year-old men. They're coming over ready to fuck and fight. Those are the immigrants that... the migrants that Europe is welcoming in. There's one hot one. I'm still not sure it's worth it. Don't believe the governments of Europe and the media. They can fake the news, but the pictures speak for themselves. Migrants are overwhelmingly fighting age men. Have you ever seen those pictures, by the way? I'm sorry I don't have one, but you know, there's those pictures in the German press of families, and Swedish press too, of families who have taken in a sort of 24-year-old Syrian migrant. And you'll get this sort of, you'll get the husband who looks like, you know, cucked as fuck. Some sort of bespectacled dork blogger. Who's got sort of an improbably hot wife who's sitting there like, oh. And in between the two of them, there's this like strapping 22-year-old Syrian. You're like, okay, I get it. Okay, now I understand. Yes, good for you, love. Good Lord. The unfortunately vicious cycle we see with Muslim immigration is that young men are more radical, and they radicalize the young men already in the country. With the percentage of Muslims on welfare, they have nothing better to do with their time than plan how to install a Sharia-compliant culture. Turns out, far from when in Rome behaving as Romans do, when in Rome, Muslims rape everyone and claim welfare. Oh, come on. Where did you think you were coming this evening? Muslims who have entered Europe are very plain about telegraphing their future intentions. They have no plans to fit into the culture. Muslims do not believe that when in Rome you should do as the Romans do. In Dusseldorf, Muslims burned down an exhibition center that had been turned into a refugee center. It was a museum that was turned into accommodations for people in need. They burned it down. The fire caused 10 million euros in damage and 26 people were nearly killed. You want to know the reason? They burned it down. Not enough candy and chocolate were made available during Ramadan. It's okay, you can laugh, it is funny. Nobody died. They don't just want to be taken in and given a safe land to start a new life. They want to bend the knee of Western civilization the ways they always have, with swords and fire. The situation in Europe is grim. Rape gangs and crime in Germany, a total takeover in Sweden, no-go zones in Paris, and similar problems in London. As I wrote in the fall, London is essentially lost. The natural question is, how's Europe responded? And the answers to that question are extremely troubling. These are the defense ministers of the leading European... The leading European nations, these are the people charged with the safety and security of European countries. Yep, no fucking hope. It's like putting the army in Amy Schumer's hands. Oh, God. Amy Schumer as Barbie. I mean, in a way, Amy Schumer is the perfect modern feminist icon. Sort of untalented, unattractive, fat, obnoxious cunt. But, sullying a fine institution like Barbie, I have a feeling that it will end up something like Ghostbusters. Yes, and I'm sure when it bombs at the box office, it will be the fault of anonymous internet misogynists. These are the people charged with the defense of Europe. She got something in her teeth. She has. Oh, no, 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 no. Just bad dentistry. Lord. It's one good thing about America. Right. Europe opened its doors wide to Islam. I wish we could just blame Angela Merkel, but it isn't just her. It's all the leaders of the European Union. Eastern Europe seems to be holding out. Maybe I should just move to Hungary. German court just ruled it could not... What? They did. No, so they were told by Angela Merkel, you've got to take this many refugees, and Hungary just went, no. No. Well, fair play to them. Hungary was, a German court just ruled that it could not deport a Muslim man to Hungary, to Hungary from Germany because they treat Muslims inhumanely. Good! I'm curious what they mean by inhumanely, because Hungary is a damn sight better place to live than most of the Middle East. Presumably they mean no candy and chocolate during Ramadan. My guess is they aren't offering third wives or free goats. But it's too easy, but it's true. You've seen the drone footage. I know you have. Or perhaps Hungary has declined to make Jew hunting and apostate stoning national sports. Germany and other countries have argued that immigration is important to bring workers into the economy, but these men don't bring work skills, and they won't to your country either. They know how to radicalize, they know how to shoot, how to stab, how to bomb, how to blow up Westerners and to rape women, and of course run them over with trucks, as the terrorist attack in Nice has taught us, but they don't bring very much else. In fact, many of the words and actions of the leadership of Europe betray a sort of sick desire to end their own culture. It's really the only way you can explain it. They sort of hate themselves and their culture so much, like a sort of, like a BuzzFeed blogger, you know? These guys are like, oh, straight white men are the worst thing to happen ever. Aren't you a straight, what is wrong with you? Sort of male feminists. You know, this ugly disease. It's almost as bad. It just mystifies me. People can hate their own kind that much. Hate themselves so much that they decide that cultural annihilation is an appropriate response to some sort of misguided global guilt over God knows what. It's hard to fathom. Leadership of Europe knows that Islam will end European culture, and they are okay with this. I hope one day to meet someone smart enough to explain it to me. I hope, however, that America never falls for this stuff. America has now a leader who spends, who is good, better on this stuff. I hope that America, in all of its history, you know, for as long as there is the nation, never has to experience a leader who hates the country, who spends all of his time apologizing to foreigners, importing radical Islam by the boatload. I hope that you never have a leader who despises the country so much that he spends almost his entire presidency apologizing for it rather than defending it. Culturally speaking, the Western world has done itself no favors with plunging birth rates. You people should be having a lot more kids. You cannot have a future unless you create a future with what we need at a very minimum, which is lots of babies. Wars are not won on the battlefield. Wars in historical terms. We started this talking about ancient history. We'll finish it. In a similar way. Wars are not won on the battlefield. Cultural wars are won demographically. And demographic suicide from the West puts us at a precarious position when we compare ourselves to Islam, whose policies have many children, sometimes by multiple women. Possibly the only good thing about Islam. No, actually, it's not the only good thing about Islam. The other good thing about Islam is in Saudi Arabia, no women drivers. It's the only thing they get right. Sometimes you can arrive at the right conclusions for the wrong reasons, you know. Their road traffic accident statistics must be the envy of the world. John Paul II's biographer, George Weigel, put it like this. Europe's crisis of civilizational morale, which is the reason for Europe's demographic suicide, involves the eclipse of Christianity as the principal culture-forming force in Europe. Christianity's replacement by various left-wing secularist schemes of human perfectibility set the stage for Europe's attempts at self-destruction. First in three totalitarian systems, the two world wars, the Cold War, and now through demographic suicide. I happen to think he's right about the loss of religion being a major contributing factor. But beyond all causes and motivations, if Europe wants to remain Europe, it must have more Europeans. That should be a warning to the US as well. Cultural clash with Islam is not entirely lost. Europe can be saved, and we can metaphorically and perhaps, you know, depending on how angry Daddy gets, literally take back Constantinople. Firstly, I mean, my preference is just to, you know, go in hard and nuke Mecca. But someone liked it. But if we can't do that, which I understand may have some ramifications, we can't... They want to join Europe? Give up Islam. Let's see. All right. Now, if we can't do any of those things, we can at least fix the demographic problems and look to European countries that have resisted the Islamic surge as a model for how America should now treat the problem. The tough bastards of Eastern Europe know perfectly well how to preserve their culture, and we can learn from them. Our old friends, the Hungarians, and look up what they actually did in Hungary. They're sort of like Cuban Americans. You know, they remember what it was like to be ruled by totalitarian, culture-hating leftists, and they know how to nip it in the bud. And secondly, we can push hard to make sure that the glorious President Daddy follows through on his promises as they relate to Muslim immigration. Doesn't it feel great to say President Trump? I mean, it feels very naughty. It feels very naughty. It feels subversive. It feels like it's not real. And of course, for another 3.5 weeks, it isn't. But when it is, President Trump. Can you believe that we did it? President Trump. God, they're so mad. Wonderful. Wonderful thing. Wonderful thing. Trump's response to Orlando and his speeches generally about this problem reveal that he knows it's a bad reason to let people in who want to kill us all. He also knows we must be able to vet immigrants and refugees. He knows above all else that making America great and welcoming in Islam are mutually exclusive futures. And if you can't get that around your head, if you can't accept that, if you can't wrap your head around it, what is that? What? Oh, it is? Oh, I was leaning, wasn't I? Yeah. Cheap shit. Well, I've got one pillar left. I thought it was polystyrene. Fuck. Do we pay a lot for that? That's one bit of staging we can't reuse. That's my favourite shirt. If you don't understand, we should just do the other one, really. If you don't understand that, what? No, don't encourage me. If you don't understand that mass Muslim immigration and making America great again are mutually exclusive futures, you are like Hillary, like Bernie Sanders, like Jill Stein, like pretty much every celebrity you've ever heard of, part of the problem. And you will never be able to save people from what is coming. You will never be able to become part of the solution. Now, we put leaders in roles willing to defend our cultures and values. Trump has already started to do this. He has made Mad Dog Mattis Secretary of Defense. And this is what Mad Dog Mattis has to say, the most alpha guy in the world. You go into Afghanistan, you got guys who slap women around for 5 years because they didn't wear a veil. You know, guys like that, they ain't got no manhood left anyway. So it's a hell of a lot of fun to shoot them. Actually, it's quite fun to fight them, you know. It's a hell of a hoot. It's fun to shoot some people. It's a gay British man in a dress telling you that it's fun to shoot people. It's fun to shoot some people. I'll be right up there with you. I like brawling. The guy's fucking amazing. He really gets it. Here, by the way, is one more of his quotes before I finish. Imagine anyone in the Obama administration saying this. Americans will not ask one fundamental question. Is political Islam in the best interests of the United States? I suggest the answer is no, but we need to have the discussion. If we won't even ask the question, how do we recognize our side is in a fight? There's one certain way to continue losing against Islam, and that is to not be willing to have an honest and forthright conversation about what is happening in Europe and what will happen here if that is not resisted. Does General Mattis strike you as someone who is not willing to discuss a subject that may make liberals upset or squeamish? Does Donald Trump? No, they're not. And it just may be the case that Donald Trump, for all of his occasional silliness, could be the guy against all odds to save Western civilization. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening. I will... Where are we? 8:19. I'm very happy to take some questions. Oh, you're going to do that, are you? Okay, I'm very happy to take some questions. Thank you so much for thank you to the front two rows for standing this time. I'm very happy to take some questions for as long as I have available. If you'd like to stand, I think that Andrew's going to come find you with a mic. The lady here in the what color is that? Is that sort of few?
Salmon.
The lady and the salmon.
Oh. Okay. Wow, I didn't expect I was actually going to be able to go first here. Would you look at that?
Well, there we go. Sometimes it's nice to come first.
Milo, I love you. Thank you so much for coming.
Let's see, we already have something in common.
I actually have, it's kind of like a two-part question.
Go ahead.
Why do you think there are so many people who claim to be liberal, who live their lives as conservatives and not even really realize it? Mm-hmm. And about your statistics about the Muslim Americans wanting Sharia law, don't mm-hmm. you think that heavily resembles what the left is doing with their hate speech or what they claim to be hate speech?
Okay, so the first, I think most people are sort of natural libertarians, not necessarily conservative or progressives. I think they're pulled in that direction by cultural forces, by their experiences. I think people are nudged in a particular political direction by circumstance. But I think fundamentally people just want to be left the fuck alone, left to pursue... I think people want to be left to pursue their own destiny as they're able to. I think people want to be able to read, do, say, be anything, dress how they like, speak how they like, hang out with whoever they want, find whatever interesting that they want, publish what they want, use whatever language they choose to use to express themselves. I think most people are like that. I think that is something in our nature. I think that's natural human instinct, is to want to express ourselves and to sometimes to be transgressive and to break boundaries. I think people get drawn to various kinds of politics over their life through their experiences. So if you are fat, lonely, miserable, or stupid, you might end up a Democrat. If you are hardworking, you aspire to great things, you're disciplined, you believe in the value of hard work and tradition and all the other wonderful things that have built society and made the West a nice place to live, you might end up as a Republican. But fundamentally, our nature is libertarian. So, as to your question of why do so many liberals why do people just identify as liberals whilst living really as conservatives, I think those labels basically are breaking down. I think the great distinction today is between people who want to be left alone and people who want to control how others live. Now, the conservatives who want to control how others live are relatively small in number these days. The religious right doesn't have the same purchase that it used to. The Republican establishment can't do what it used to do in terms of legislating social issues, all the rest of it. Now it's progressives, it's social justice warriors who will tell you what language you can use, tell you what you can believe in, tell you who you can like, and all the rest of it. But I think the primary gap between people these days is between libertarians and authoritarians. I think it's between people who believe that they know better how others should live and people who just want to be left alone. And the majority of the people who just want to be left alone, or who at least want to pursue their own greatness and their own flourishing and their own value and virtue, without sort of language codes, speech codes, without the authoritarian oppressive kind of oversight of the government or anyone else, those people voted for Trump. Those people voted for Trump because they were sick of being lied to and lied about. I think that maybe the people you're describing have kind of broke out their shell the last election. What was your second question? She has some gravitas. Yes. Well, you make the mistake, well, maybe not, you don't, but don't make the mistake of interrogating the political left with logic and reason, because they don't work that way. They've given up looking at the world through a logical lens and replaced that with identity politics. They've replaced it with feelings, with who you are and what you are, rather than what you believe. They have decided that your skin color, your sexuality, your gender matters more than the contents of your character. There was some guy once in American history, whose name I forget, who said that it would be nice if we judge people by the contents of their character, not the color of their skin. Maybe some progressive can fill me in who that was. But I was joking. I know who it was. I thought that was a fairly decent way to behave to other people, a fairly reasonable way to conduct ourselves. Progressives have given up on that. It leads to logical absurdities. The idea that you would pander to and mollycoddle radical Islam at the expense of gays and women, for instance, shows you that progressives no longer believe in logic and reason, and instead they're interested in constructing a hierarchy of victimhood, the sort of pyramid of oppression. Right at the top you've got Muslims and trannies. And right down the bottom now, you've got white gay men, because our whiteness and our maleness trumps our dick sucking. we benefit from our skin color and our gender more than we suffer from our sexuality, apparently. The problem with these tables is that Muslims are at the top of the oppression league table. The problem with that is they want to kill everyone else on the table. They want to kill the blacks, they want to kill the women, they want to kill the gays, they want to kill the trannies, they want all the rest of us dead. And this is only confusing to you if you continue to interrogate the political left according to reason, logic, and good sense. What they're instead interested in doing is importing Marxist economic philosophy about oppressors and oppressed, producers and victims, into the social sphere. It doesn't make any sense to talk in monetary terms about the relations between the sexes, but what you can do is introduce, this is a cultural Marxism you hear about, what you can do is introduce this dynamic of the oppressor and the oppressed into every social relationship you care to mention. And it just so happens that in every single instance the left can come up with, straight white men are the oppressors. Well, it ain't so. There are plenty of people in this country really suffering who happen to fall into that category. And Donald Trump spoke to some of those people at the last election. Those people are tired of being lied to and lied about. They're tired of progressives telling them that they are bigots and racists and homophobes. And they're just tired of it. So stop trying to interrogate the progressive left on the basis of logic and reason, because they don't work that way. and instead, treat them with the tools that they, approach them with the strategies that they have approached conservatives with for the last 30 years, the most effective of which is laugh them off the face of the earth, because they deserve it. Next question. Thanks. Andrew. You sort of stood prematurely. came a little early. Let's go. All right, let's go. Let's go. This is the guy at the front. Yes. Bowie. Is that a David Bowie t-shirt?
Absolutely.
I threw up in his sink,
Awesome. Fantastic.
I threw up in his sink about four or five years ago, and he insisted on cleaning it up himself. And I was terrific. So embarrassed I had to leave. What's the question?
All right, so you brought up Gary Johnson earlier and how he's an idiot. I wanted to bring up the fact that he's not only an idiot, but he's also a cuck. And he unleashed a wave.
This is true.
He unleashed a wave of cuckery on the libertarian movement that's really taken hold. Mm-hmm. I was just wondering, do you think that this wave of cuckery is irreversible, or is it a lost cause?
Sorry, we were talking about libertarians. I got bored. Oh. No, I'm just kidding. Any ladies in the audience who's urban decay? It's good stuff, isn't it? Yeah, there we go. Sorry, what was your question? Sorry, it's Gary Johnson. I just tuned out. What was the... Oh, no, libertarians are defined by cuckery. I am in broad terms a libertarian, but the libertarians, through their obsession with weed, Bitcoin, and hacking, have very little to say of substance. It's a sort of admission that you've given up trying to find a system that works. You've given up trying to work out what a virtuous society might look like and instead retreated into just let me do what I want. Now, to say that most people want to be left alone and not language policed isn't the same thing as I have no idea what a society should be organized like, I have no idea what the size of the state should be, I have no idea like what kind of foreign policy we should have, and I don't care. I'm just going to be like, I'm just going to go and like mine some more Bitcoin today. That's the face, sad to say, of the modern Libertarian Party, which we saw in that glorious obese streaker. Do you remember him? Was that his name? Who even knows? But at the Libertarian Party conference this year, some fat cunt just sort of wandered across the stage with no clothes on. They're a joke. They deserve to be a joke. There is a long, proud, beautiful history of libertarianism as best exemplified by J.S. Mill on liberty, classical liberalism. Do what the hell you want as long as you're not affecting other people, which deserves to be defended, and I'm a proud supporter of the modern Libertarian Party and sort of Reddit libertarians. Deserve nothing but ritual public humiliation, so I intend to continue giving them. Yeah. Blondie in the navy shirt, yeah. There we go.
How are you doing,
man? I'm good, thank you. Oh, come on, you can make it over there.
So, thank you for coming to Michigan State University.
Thank you
really
for having
me. Really
proud
to have
me.
You here,
thank
especially
you.
Me. I guess my question is, after a lot of hate Republicans get, what can college kids do on campus and possibly on the internet to kind of push back this hatred that the left gives us?
Oh, laugh. What, I've said this in so many college talks and nobody ever really listens. Well, they do listen, but you know, most people are tuned out of the live stream by then. by the time we get to the Q&A, people are like, okay, I get it. The sound that authoritarians and dictators hate the most is the sound of laughter, because it's the sound of freedom. And it's the sound, it means that dissidence and mischief and subversion are permitted. And this is one of the very few countries where you can laugh at almost anyone. You can't laugh at some people. You can't laugh at Leslie Jones. ugly, mannish cunt. You can't laugh at Leslie Jones without consequence if you have any kind of public profile, but you can laugh at most people most of the time. And it's worth preserving that. It's worth protecting that. The most powerful weapon in your arsenal, the best thing you can do, is to keep holding people to account with the power of ridicule, because nobody can resist the truth wrapped in a good joke. And it's very difficult to get in trouble if you're really, really funny. Which is what I'm counting on. I'm trying my best not to get deported, relying on being funny. But ultimately, being able to make people laugh is a way to connect with others, and it's something the left used to have a monopoly on, but they don't anymore. Now the right does, to be frank. And we saw that in this election with meme culture, with Pepe, with all of the kind of great culture surrounding Donald Trump. It was the right's turn to laugh. And I think over the next 10 years, you're going to start to see right-leaning comedians and libertarian comedians much braver. And the other thing to say on this subject is you know, the left has had a monopoly on culture for a really long time. They've been able to tell you what it's okay to laugh about, who you're supposed to like, you know, inflicting Schumer and Dunham on us, you know, magazine covers and all the rest of it, odious, grotesque, talentless, unattractive harpies, you know, instructing us that we must find these women attractive and funny or we're sexist, racist monsters. You know, none of this stuff is true, and now people know it isn't true, and a space has opened up for us to start laughing again. And the most important thing really you can do is to laugh, because the left would have you believe that telling the wrong kind of joke about somebody, you know, could be racist, could be sexist, you know. Oh, well, you can't tell that joke because you're not black. You can't tell that joke because you're not a woman. You can't tell that joke because you're not gay. It's fucking preposterous. It's so ridiculous. If I want to tell a joke about black people, I will. And you might laugh and you might not. If I want to tell a joke about rape, I will. I find rape quite funny and sort of sort of desirable. But and it's up to me whether I choose to make myself the butt of the joke or you. If I want to put on my Grindr profile to some of you know this already. If I want to put on my Grindr profile to indicate to people that I would like to sleep with African Americans, don't contact me if you're under 7 inches or you know who your dad is. I find it funny. And you know what happens when you tell a joke like that? What happens? Nothing! Nobody fucking dies! Nothing bad happens. And, you know, the most appropriate response to these sort of hand-wringing progressive lunatics who say that jokes can be sexist, racist, all the rest of it is that. Nothing bad happens. There's no such thing. You know, this offense-taking, grievance culture, it doesn't mean anything. I'm really offended by that. Yeah. It doesn't mean anything. It's not an argument. It's not a reason to censor another person. And actually, and here's the really crucial thing, it's a really important thing. I was telling a journalist about this earlier today. Humor isn't alienating, like the left would like you to believe that it is. Humor brings us together. When you meet somebody for the first time, you know, if you're sexually attracted to them, you kind of make an awkward joke or whatever, it breaks the ice, you know? Or you meet somebody who looks different from you or sounds different from you. You might make a joke about where they come from or what they look like. Breaks the ice, lets you know that you're, you know, human beings. Humor brings us together. And jokes about our different identities, our different appearances, our different preferences. These things bind us. They don't drive us apart. The left wants you to believe because it believes that all language is dangerous, potentially hateful. Wants you to believe that the slightest sexually or racially charged comment could result in, you know, racial Armageddon. Actually, what comedians who have done a really bad job of you know, their responsibility to push boundaries in this country, what comedians have known for quite some time in this country, or they've always known, I mean, comedians should get this. They of all people should know this. What comedy does is bring us together. And the sound of laughter is something the progressive left now hates because they can't control it. They can't police it. They can't dictate what you find funny. And that is the best strategy you have at your disposal. It is the best weapon against them because it makes you likable and popular, and they can't stand that because they hate glamour and aspiration and beauty. You can see why they hate me so much. They hate anything they can't control. And nobody can control what makes you laugh. So the best weapon in your arsenal is laughter. Continue to laugh at them. Continue to point out their hypocrisies and lunacy and ridiculousness. And at every available opportunity, wrap the truth in a good joke. Because if you do that, you will win. Everybody underestimates how funny Donald Trump is. Like, nobody, I don't know, I understand why nobody got this. Like, the guy's fucking hilarious. I mean, he came to, do you think he doesn't know? Do you think he doesn't get it? He, like, comes down on this, like, marble escalator and says, Mexicans are rapists, and is like, I'm running for president. It's so funny. It's really funny. And he's like doing this amazing stuff. Like, you know, I promise and pledge the American people and my supporters, I will obey, I will abide by the results of this election. If I win. And then, you know, everybody goes crazy. He's got this shit-eating grin on his face. You're like, You think he doesn't know? You think he doesn't know how funny he is? Of course he does. He's hilarious. And that's one of the reasons he won. So remember that as you go about your business. Laughter is not just the best medicine, but is the most powerful political weapon you have.
Two more, Milo.
Okay, sorry, I went on for a long time. I'm sorry. But it was a good answer. Why are you pointing at someone? Why are you pointing? You think he can't wave for himself? Is it somebody who... Is it herself? You? Why is he pointing for you? Does he think you need help? This is very patronizing. Are you a sexist, sir? You think she can't look after her? No, I didn't say her. No. I didn't say she got a question. I was just asking why he was white knighting her. She's perfectly capable of lifting her hand herself. No, I think you should...
He's Turkish, that's why.
Oh. Well... Give me back my fucking orange groves. I'll take the question from the lady.
Please point at me because we have a gift for you because thank you to MSU for inviting us students from DePaul to come see you.
Oh, goodness. Thank you.
Like our first time. So we have a gift for you to protest your excommunication and Ben's ban. We have Make DePaul Great Again hats.
Oh, thank you.
This is for
you. Very happy about that. Let me come. I've got lipstick over my fingers now. Let me come and get it off you. Thank you so much. Oh, thank you. Wonderful. Look, Make DePaul Great Again. Well, you've got a big mission ahead. This is. Thank you so much. This is a Catholic university that has some of the most enthusiastic abortion activists in the country. DePaul University. Their leaders have been called into the Vatican no fewer than 9 times over the last 10 years to explain why that college is so fucking mental. I, of course, had somebody storm the stage, snatch the mic. His drugged-up little friend kind of took a swing for me. I was pathetic. Well, all these sort of, like, you know, very angry black girls were kind of lining the stage. I said, well, they're probably just here because I fucked their brothers. Very angry. If they don't... You know, they're here from Black Lives Matter, which is funny because if they don't move soon, the black incarceration rates are going to go even higher. Oh, come on. The first one was way worse than that. So anyway, thank you for that. I will wear this with pride and pleasure next time I'm in Chicago, which is in about 2 days. So thank you so much. Did you have a question as well, or were you just being lovely and giving me a gift? Oh, but you see, I see you, and I see you're too beautiful to stay off the Trump train forever. You see, hot people always end up going Trump. So, you know. Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to wipe my lipstick. This is horrible. How do women do this? Have I smudged it? Is it all right? I don't even know. Well, thank you. I've never worn this before. Okay, we can do 2 more questions. Don't listen to him. Let's do, actually no, we're going to do affirmative action. We're going to choose the lady over there in the purple, with the blonde hair. Yeah, you. How many blonde women in purple do you think there are in that row?
I'm sorry, it was, I mean, I would be wearing a Milo shirt if it came in on time when I ordered it in September, so first
of
all,
I'm so... Oh, good heavens, I'm sorry. Are you the lady that emailed me?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, you are. And I will check up on that for you after the show, and if I'll give you this. I will check up on that for you after the show. Come and see us. What's the question, lady?
First of all, that's one of my formerly many stickers on your hat, but... Second of all, I was going to ask more about your views on communism since this summer I visited Hungary and I visited what they call their House of Terror, which was basically, it was the Nazis and the Soviets both shared the same building. Mm-hmm. And basically we got to see the basement where many people were tortured and killed. Yeah. And after that, I used to be so far left that my parents said I made a circle. But after that... After that, my views on communism, everything drastically changed. So since I haven't heard you talk much on communism, mm-hmm. I wanted to know your views since there's a lot of commies
sure.
outside.
Sure. They were lovely. Well, I even came dressed as one. a lot more glamorous and beautiful. But, well, it is a political ideology that has been probably the most underreported version of hatefulness in the history of our species. I mean, communism has killed a hell of a lot more people than fascism has. Not that it's a competition. You know, I'm not the sort of person that gets into body counts, but if I were, communism wins. It's a weird sort of thing. It's become a sort of glamorous, well, you know, I don't think it is anymore, actually. I think it was, for a very long time, a kind of glamorous moment in culture that, you know, you could sort of wear a hammer and sickle, or you could, you know, wear a Che Guevara t-shirt. And it was sort of all right because somehow they were seen as hot because they were sweaty and they had beards and they came from some sort of, you know, non-American country. So they must have been cool. People are starting to realize, I think, just how horrific conditions are in countries that are run in that way. And it's partly as a result of globalization, with more people moving in more directions all the time. So you've got more people telling each other, like, well, I lived under communism, and no. You know. And it's partly also, I think, as people start to see the difference between totalitarian top-down regimes in the East and the freedom and democracy of property rights in the West. Ultimately, and this is a, you know, the thing that I don't talk about very much, but this is important to understand, gender studies departments, African studies departments, you know, the Soros-funded protest groups, modern feminism, Black Lives Matter, these people are all, when it comes down to it, when it ultimately boils down to it, really interested primarily not in gender or race, but in dismantling capitalism. They don't believe in the system that has made America great. Donald Trump obviously does. But these people don't believe in democracy, property rights, freedom of expression, capitalism. They don't believe in any of the things that have made the West a nice place to live. They don't believe in any of the things that have made the West a nice place if you're a woman or a minority, or a nice place if you just want to make a good go of it, start a business, and be a success. They don't like that system very much. Your media doesn't either. I mean, 98% of journalists are total fucking cunts. You know, they are hopeless incompetents, liars, and political ideologues. And they simply don't believe in any of the things that have made this country really awesome. That's because they're communists. That's because they're socialists. You know, not to use words that have been perhaps exhausted by, you know, fanatics, but ultimately, what this stuff boils down to, you know, is a globalist, is a sort of globalist communist agenda, and it is ugly, and it results in pain, misery, suffering, inequality, all the things that progressives claim they hate. The best system to reduce inequality between the very rich and the very poor, the best system to give everybody an equal shot, regardless of their circumstances of birth, whether they're women or gays or blacks or whatever, the best system is the one you have in America. It's not perfect, but it is the best system that exists anywhere in the world, because it is characterized by democracy, freedom, capitalism, property rights, and all of the other things that have made America the greatest country in the history of human civilization. It is that. And many of the people in your university departments, in your media, and in Hollywood simply don't share our values. They are a problem. and, you know, much of what I talk about, although I don't articulate it exactly in those terms, really is about communism. So if you want to take it sort of a step further from the stuff I do, whether it's Islam or feminism, Black Lives Matter, whatever, take it a step further. It is about a clash of civilizations. It is about people who simply do, the people who do and the people who do not believe in capitalism. Capitalism is the best system for organizing society that humankind has yet come up with. If America loses that, it loses everything. And I'm glad that with Trump's election, it looks like you've at least hung on to it for another few generations. Let me do. Well, I just don't believe it's real. I don't think that millennials believe like you think they believe. I think you've just got a very small, very loud contingent of assholes who work at BuzzFeed and who, you know, and who are sort of bloggers and work in the entertainment business. I just don't believe that millennials are all that mental. And let me give you, and I think we better wrap up there, but let me give you one little glimmer of hope before I leave, which is my fans start at like 13. Somebody even came to my show, it was 12 years old, a few days ago. Let me tell you, if you're worried about millennials and how crazy your fellow millennials are, as scared as people my age, 35, perhaps down to 25, are about admitting that maybe feminism isn't all it's cracked up to be. And maybe Black Lives Matter isn't the way to save black people. And maybe, you know, actually America's pretty great. Fairly uncontroversial statements, but things that people my age don't generally make, and people your age don't, statements people your age don't generally make. As fearful and as reticent as my generation is, 13-year-olds, 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds are incredibly bold and incredibly clear and incredibly forthright about just how much they fucking hate progressives. They really are. And you haven't seen the impact of this yet. I'm probably the only person in America who really sees the scale of this. They really sees the, you know, just how many people there are like this. There are videos that circulate inside BuzzFeed, and I know this because I, you know, do have friends that work everywhere, even places like that. There are people that work inside BuzzFeed that, you know, who tell me, you know, there are videos circulating there that go viral of, like, young girls ridiculing feminism and BuzzFeed while they're playing video games, like 13-year-olds. There are signs that BuzzFeed's younger viewers just absolutely hate their race baiting, you know, like 25 things I think of when I hear the word white, and you've got these, you know, like spoiled brat cunts. It's like, well, I just think of like oppression, and it just makes me like really feel like I just like not safe in my own environment. Young people hate this shit. They hate it. They see it for what it is. And it's partly a reaction to their own parents' generation, because you've got to remember, like, I'm 32 now. You know, 35-year-olds are parents now. And they have kids who are like 9 or 12 or whatever, depending on how slutty they were. And these kids are partly rebelling against the politics of their parents and partly just seeing this stuff for what it is. So if you're feeling sad or if you're feeling, if you're worried about the apparent and complete victory of progressivism over the millennial generation, I would just say sit tight and watch what people who are 13 today do when they get to 18, when they really hit the internet properly, because they hate feminism. They hate Black Lives Matter. They hate Hillary Clinton. They hate Lena Dunham. They hate Amy Schumer. They hate all of that stuff. They really, really loathe it. And, you know, people say with sort of dreary regularity that politics comes in cycles and culture operates in cycles. It has been 30 years since progressives had a good kick in the teeth, since they stopped running everything and stopped being in charge of everything. Let me tell you, it is coming. It is not just coming heralded by people like me, but it is a generational change. There's an entire generation of young Americans who will not stand for this shit any longer. They are coming. They will back you up. They are there. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you. Thank you.